So sit back, relax, put your feet up, but most of all, enjoy. Much love.
The Alukus, also known as the Boni, are survivors. Roughly 8,000 strong, the Alukus are an African-American Maroon people whose territory lies on the borderlands of French Guiana and Suriname, in a part of the Amazon basin that extends to the northeastern coast of South America and belongs culturally as much to the Caribbean as to Amazonia. Born out of resistance to slavery some 3 centuries ago, the Alukus have endured to the present in the face of formidable odds. Today, their survival is threatened once again, as they cope with the assimilationist policies of the French state, of which most Alukus are now citizens, as well as ever-escalating incursions into their territory by multinational corporations and independent gold miners. The fate of their Amazonian rainforest environment, not to mention their cultural and political autonomy, hangs precariously in the balance. Of Maroon peoples in the Americas to have survived to the present, others include the Ndayuka, Saramaka, Matawai, Paramaka, and Quinti of Suriname, the Maroons of Jamaica, and the Palenqueros of Colombia. During the 18th century, the Dutch colony of Suriname, also known as Dutch Guiana, which played a prominent role in the European trade in sugar and slaves, was home to one of the most brutal slave regimes in history. Beginning around 1712 and continuing for several decades thereafter, the African ancestors of the Alukus fled the slave plantations that dotted the coastal portion of this colony and sought refuge in the surrounding forests. While waging a fierce guerrilla war against the Dutch slavocracy, the early Alukus foiled the colonial government's attempts to re-enslave or annihilate them by hiding out in one of the most inhospitable parts of coastal Suriname, the swamplands of the Cotica River region. During this period, even as they adapted to a challenging natural environment and fought back the repeated onslaughts of Dutch colonial troops, they succeeded in laying the foundations of a new Afro-Guianese society. They also created their own variant of a rich Creole language, with a vocabulary derived largely from English but also drawing on Portuguese, Dutch, French, and a wide variety of African languages, as well as a vibrant musical culture, which remains one of the most African in the Western Hemisphere. Finally forced out of their haunts in coastal Suriname by a massive Dutch military campaign during the 1770s, they crossed the Maroni, in Dutch, Marowin, River into the French colony of Guyane, French Guiana. As they headed farther upriver into the wilderness, they continued their fight for survival, first against the Galibi, Carib, Indians they encountered in the forest, then against the Dutch and their Ndayuka Maroon allies, sent out in a renewed attempt to quash them. By then, the Ndayuka, another Maroon group with a much larger population than the Alukus, had made a treaty with the Dutch and agreed to assist them in subduing any Maroons that remained hostile to them. The Alukus, in fact, were the last major holdouts among the Guianese Maroons. For decades after the Ndayuka made peace with the Dutch in 1760, followed by the Saramaka Maroons, who signed another treaty with the Dutch in 1762, the Alukus continued fighting their former enslavers. Because of their ongoing attacks on coastal plantations, the Alukus quickly gained a reputation as the boldest and fiercest of the Surinamese Maroon peoples. For the next century, the Alukus enjoyed freedom and autonomy with little interference from the other inhabitants of French Guiana and Suriname, whose main settlements were located far away in the coastal area. The situation began to change rapidly, however, in 1969, when the separately administered interior zone of French Guiana known as the Territoire de Elanini, where the Alukus and other tribal populations lived, was fully incorporated politically into the French state, French Guiana having been made an overseas department of France in 1946. As patterns of labor migration caused the Alukus population to shift from traditional villages to newly established municipal centers constructed in their own territory with French funds, as well as to the peripheries of coastal towns such as Cayenne, Kourou, Saint-Laurent-du-Maroni, and Paramaribo, the capital of Suriname, there was a growing feeling among the Alukus that their traditional way of life was under siege. Among the most important social events in traditional Alukus life was a complex series of funerary rites that were essential to the transition of a deceased Alukus from the world of the living to that of the ancestors. Beginning with a ceremony known as Buko Day, a kind of first funeral, and ending with another called Piubaka, a kind of second funeral culminating in the lifting of the period of mourning, this process could take 1 year or more to complete. These death rites had always served a powerful integrative function in Alukus life, activating and bringing together intersecting networks of kin from different villages and matriclans, who would gather in the deceased's home village and cooperate in a series of material and ritual exchanges. No less important than these ritual measures were the simultaneous performances of music and dance to honor the deceased, without which he or she could not proceed on the final journey to Didikand, the realm of the dead. These collective rites and the associated forms of music and dance remained as important as ever in the 1980s and 90s. Indeed, they continue to be practiced and remain essential today, despite the ever-intensifying pressures on the Alukus to assimilate to the dominant cultures of the larger societies of which they now form a part.
Thanks for watching this video. I hope to see you soon. Till the next time, much love.